previous session we talked about diodes. Now we are going to the next level of complexity. Now when we talk about BJTs, all my 17 years of teaching, you know, I had lot of difficulty teaching BJTs. I am sure you would have had the same difficulty. So we have to innovate ways of teaching it, and this is by definition a complex device. Again, coming back to importance of, let us say, analog electronics in particular. Now in modern times, for example, with the IT, everybody has gone into computers. Similarly, if you ask students which part of the syllabus in basic electronics they like, what will be the answer? Digital electronics, very good. That's always the answer. Which is digital electronics is what they like. And you ask them what you hate most, they'll say analog electronics. Okay. Now at the same time, the that's why I say it's always a very big challenge to teach analog electronics in a way they understand. Now today, anybody with a hardware knowledge is a rare commodity. Okay. Now why is it so? What do you think? What is the reason? I was very fortunate when I was studying in Kerala in 1974 to 78. You know, there was a lot of emphasis on experiment. Lot of emphasis. In fact, I was so enthused. I didn't have much money at that time, but still, whatever money I had, I used to buy components, solder them in my hostel, and bring it to the lab. I never wired in my lab. So thrilled to see what will I get. You know, that helped a lot. What I'm trying to say is, analog electronics actually by definition is tough. Okay, digital that way is by far much simpler. But why is it tough? It's because, you know, the actual understanding of a device. Once you understand a device, then things simpler. And the understanding of a circuit. So our job is to make that, you know, that learning curve, you know, simpler. But another very important thing, I'm sure. I'm sorry if I sometimes, you know, talk as though I'm talking to students. But I'm sure your experience also is the same thing, that when you teach, one of the basic things they talk in B.Ed or somewhere, they always say, you know, we all learn by repetition. So in what I always do in my all classes, irrespective of PG, UG, I always, first thing I ask in my class always is what I taught in the previous class, and you can always see they looking back, and there is a very good evidence that they did not look at it. Okay. I mean, I am sure you would also have the same situation there also. But one of the things is repetition. I remember last semester when I taught basic electronics course transistors, I had to repeat my basic lecture at least 3 times. But I was very happy. I was very happy. Each time I could see a smile on their face. Okay, and you could see there is a delta exchange. Okay. So what I am trying to say is a learning curve which you have picked up maybe 20 years, maybe I have picked up in 30 years, whatever it is, do not ever expect a student to pick up in 1 hour. Okay. So we have to give that time. Only our job is to make that job simpler and hopefully, you know, enjoyable. That is all we can do. We cannot make it simpler. But that is where I think lot of applications. So what I have done in BJT, what I have done is I have taken a route which I found very useful for with my students. I believe students are same all over. Okay. And what matters is motivation than anything else. So the way I teach transistors, that is the way I put up the lecture. Now as we all know, BJT, invention of BJT in 1948, let us say, was the starting point of all ICT we talked about today. In fact, whenever I teach a course called Introduction to Electronics, and I tell about 2 major inventions which led to what is today. Can you name the 2 basic inventions? Transistor is 1. Okay. And maybe if you go 1 level up, you can say, let us say, ICs. Okay. Then it went to IC, but started all here. Then what is second one? And I happen to work in both the areas, that is why I always take pride in that. The second one is fiber optics. Okay. I mean, I happen to teach both, so that is why I always tell this. Now so here you see transistor as a device. Any idea why this name transistor was coined? Transfer of resistance. Okay, that was supposed to be something which is not possible. Today we don't ever talk about transfer of resistance. Okay, or transformation of resistance. Today we don't talk about that. But the time when it was invented, that was the main issue. That here is a device which can transform something at an input level at a lower impedance to at a higher impedance, which was supposed to be something great. Now Here again, let us bring back the same concept of a 3-terminal device, okay. And this is something I always found useful to tell students, that being a 3-terminal device, you cannot have just one characteristic, you need at least two. And because you have 3 terminals, you have many combinations. All this I think helps them in understanding, as supposed to a diode where it is a 2-terminal device, here you have a 3-terminal device, therefore you have many combinations possible, okay. So in that way, then things become much simpler. And basic principle of a diode, a BJT, is to use the voltage between 2 terminals to control the current flowing in the 3rd terminal. Now again, PNP, NPN, I will skip it. Now one very important thing to know about is, again, very commonly students have a question, why do you say this is emitter and this is collector, even though I, with a multimeter, I measure, they all look alike. So this is something which actually we need to clarify. I mean, I do not know how many will ask that question, you know, they will care to ask that question, but at least once in a while you will have at least one such student who would ask the question. Now one thing we must remember is, the word emitter itself means that this particular region emits carriers, okay. And collector, it collects, okay. Because of the basic requirement itself, the way they are doped are very different. Emitter is very heavily doped, okay, because, and another reason why, and base is very lightly doped. Because of that, you, and collector has another, what is the other requirement of collector? One is collecting, what is the other requirement? Another very major requirement, power dissipation, okay. This is again a very good point to illustrate, very, very important. Because of that, in an actual, I think written that here, collector base regions. Now the collector will always have the largest area. If you look at the actual physical area, you will see that the collector has the largest area. Why? Even though the current flowing through emitter and a collector are the same, the why does it have higher power dissipation requirement? And why area? Okay. Now let's repeat. Let me repeat the question. The current flowing through, let us assume that the current flowing through emitter and collector is same, actually emitter is more. Even though the current flowing through emitter is more than collector, we say that the collector has larger area. Why? P is equal to V into I, okay. Then why? Across the? Yeah, the important thing is V, power dissipation is V into I. I is same, but V is VCB. Okay, collector the base voltage, which is much higher than VBE. VBE is only 0.7, whereas your VCB may be 5 volts, 10 volts. So at least 10 or 20 times. Okay, and this is why the collector is generally connected to. You know, if you have a metal transistor, collector is always connected to the body, so that you can dissipate heat. Okay, some of these things I think are very. If you can show again a device, will be very useful. And most of the time, when I teach in a class, there will be a power, sorry, a public address system. What do you have in a public address system? You will always have some, what, power transistor sitting PJ. So it is very nice to show them, look here, that is collector, you know, that helps them to understand what you mean by power dissipation. If you touch, most of the time it will be hot also. So it helps. I mean, some of this touch and feel, I would say, is very, very important, very important in learning today, especially today, okay. And then it sinks into them, and that keeps them motivated. And as I said, today's youth, they do not have more than 15 minutes of attention span. I look at my son, I can say that, okay. keep him occupied. I mean, you have to make sure that, in fact, most of the time you have to be actors in the class, okay. Sometimes you will have to tell stories nice related to the subject. You have to keep them interested and motivated so that they study. It is a tough job to be a teacher. Yeah. Now, the very important thing which is not mentioned here also. Can you think of a problem because of the very high doping of emitter? There is a very major problem. In fact, very often it is not realized, and most of the times people damage transistors like this. Fine, collector has very high dissipation requirement, but because your emitter has very high doping, you have a problem. If you apply, I am talking in terms of any reverse bias which you would connect to the base to emitter, what is the problem? No, but see, for example, one very important thing to remember is, you should never apply a negative voltage between base and emitter. The breakdown voltage at base emitter junction is typically 5 volts as opposed to breakdown between the collector, you know, base or collector emitter junction is typically 50 volt, 30 volt, 100 volt. Drastic difference. That is because of the very high doping of emitter. So, this is something very often people damage transistors like this. So, if anybody is connecting some input, especially you are trying to measure a transfer characteristics and you connect some input, make sure that your base does not get any negative voltage by putting a diode or something like that. So, very important, the significance of, you know, the high doping. Now, for the same coin you cannot reverse. If you reverse, what will happen? And we will come to that in a minute. Let us look at the modes of operation. This question will be answered there also. When you talk about modes of operation, now most of the time we are talking about active mode, where your emitter base junction is forward biased, collector base junction is reverse biased. That is what it is designed for. Okay. But you have situations where you also need cutoff and saturation. Where? Which application do you need cutoff and saturation? Switching applications. Okay. Whereas in a linear application, which is an amplifier and oscillator application, you are always talking about active mode. Okay. Now, again, if you are talking at a first year level, this is something you do not want to ever talk about. But at least if somebody asks, reverse active is what? What is reverse active mode? It is the other combination which you never use. That is, emitter to base junction you reverse bias and the collector to base junction you forward bias. Now, if you do that, what will happen? Obviously, it is not designed for that, fine. But if you do that, what will happen? Sorry? Okay. So, now essentially your change, your emitter has changed. Now, your emitter is something else, collector, and collector is emitter. Okay. It will work. But what is the problem? It will work, but with a very major difference. In an active mode, the beta is very high. Okay. Normal active mode. That active mode is also generally called normal active mode. The beta is very high, but here beta is less than 1. Okay. So, basically it is not designed for it, but there are applications where this is used. Can you tell where it is used? It is used in a very famous thing which you are all using every day. You may not have realized it. It is used, this reverse active mode is used actually in switching circuit, one something you are all familiar with, in a TTL gate. The first transistor which is used there is used in reverse active mode. It is used in both forward active mode and reverse active mode. Okay. And in fact, this just out of, if you are interested, you can see where reverse active mode is used. Okay. And the reverse active mode, if beta is less than 1, what is the inference? The base current will be larger than the collector current, okay, which is unusual, something we do not ever think about. Okay. The reverse active mode, the base current will be larger than the collector current, and that is used, that property is used in a TTL gate. The first transistor is both working in normal mode, rather saturation, as well as in the inverse active mode. But this is something I never ever mentioned in my first year class, never. I said sorry, something like that, but let us forget about it. And you say forget, they are very happy. Okay. Okay. Now, let us come to cutoff and saturation. My always the biggest problem in teaching transistors is teaching saturation. Cutoff is easy, cutoff very easy. But that is where I want to talk about the strategy I use, and I found it very useful. Before talking about common emitter amplifier, and I take another circuit and explain, we will do the same thing. And I found that works always. If necessary, I repeat it twice, thrice, but they understand the end of it. People who understand, and I like that route, I will use the same route. Now, one of the important things we must stress when we talk about, before we teach about other things, is the basic application of KCL. That in a transistor, whether it is PNP or NPN, you would see that the KCL is valid always, where is saturation, where is cutoff, where is active, it has to be, it is a basic law. Kirchhoff's current law has to be correct. And the equation which you are familiar with is nothing but KCL. Okay. So that is something which they appreciate, and they must always remember it. Why? This is very important for the saturation case. We will see that in a minute. Whereas when we talk about in a BJT in a normal active mode, your IB is much less than IC, and we talk about current gains both alpha and beta, where alpha we define as IC by IE, IC will be always less than IE. So, therefore, alpha will always be less than unity. since beta is defined as IC by IB, beta is also called the common emitter gain, and beta will always be greater than, much greater than 1. Now at the at this point we must be careful about the word beta. In fact, but I think in the first year course we make this mistake, is not a problem. Now we must be very careful about beta. When you say beta, beta is by definition what? IC, current gain, but it is by definition beta is IC by IB. Now in a saturation case, beta, what will happen to beta? Beta will, beta is not fixed. In active mode there is no problem, because beta is a constant number. What about in a circuit which is at saturation? It keeps changing. We will see a circuit right now where beta keeps on changing, but do not, so always careful, the word beta is defined as IC by IB. Okay. So different values of IC and IB can have different values of beta. Okay. So we have, so such times when in saturated circuits you would use, do not use the word beta. Generally we do not say in saturation beta will be less than, but generally the word used is beta in a saturation case is less than beta DC. That is the way it is used, but you have to be careful with the word, especially you are teaching a electric engineering student. Now again this is something you are familiar with, can be directly derived, alpha is equal to beta by beta plus 1 and beta is equal to alpha by 1 minus alpha. Now typical values of alpha and beta, if beta is typically in the range of 50 to 400 and alpha typically, you know, 0.99 and so on. In fact in the lab you would have some problem. In fact we you know, madam and all, we all had a lot of problem in the lab. Do you know why? Today the transistors you get are too good. We had problems because of the gains, beta was of the order of 400. We wanted a transistor with less beta, but finally we were able to get a transistor with less beta. We will show you one of the better. So today, so be careful about beta, you know, it is always good to play with a BJT which has less beta, and the most of this BC148 and all of them are very high betas, okay, 300, 400, and you will get into trouble. And if you do a calculation and you see that you know, nothing works. So this is important to realize, that is why, that is why the importance of doing actual experiments and even measuring beta. Yeah, so I prefer this particular circuit, and I found always this is a much better way of explaining all these three modes, this mystery. Okay, we must somehow, you know, make sure that our students do not get scared about all this, you know. And I found this is the best circuit to explain all the three modes, all three modes are present here, and they understand it well, and I sometimes go over it 2-3 times and then they get it very well. And if I think, then I tell them, you remember this circuit, if you remember this, I said you know everything about transistors, then it is only a question of changing, and I like this. So I always use this and I found it very, very, very useful. So let us take a BJT inverter, even though this is an inverter in a logic circuit, this is the best one to teach all these three modes present in the circuit, one shot, and they understand it well. So let us take a BJT inverter where you have input, you are varying from 0 to 5 volts and you are taking output from here. Let us see what happens. Now we can divide the operation of this particular one into very clearly into three regions. Let us take the first region where so we will assume something, we will assume that the VB is 0.7 volts, beta is 50, VC sat is 0.2 volts. And again some of this are very, very complex things for students to understand, we will talk about it later. So let me start with this, and the good thing about this circuit is as you change V in from 0 to VCC, the BJT goes from cutoff to active to saturation, all the three modes. So that is the beauty of this circuit, and they understand it well. So initially let us assume that the V in is less than VB. Now since V in is less than VB, base current will be 0, which means there is no collector current. Now since there is no collector current, the output voltage V out here is nothing but VCC minus ICRC. So if there is no current flowing here, this voltage is same as VCC. So that is something everybody understands, no problem. I have absolutely, people had absolutely no problems with this part. Cut off is something very, very easy to understand. So the transistor is not conducting, therefore I get full voltage out, fine, no problem. Now coming to the second case, this is the case where I define a voltage called VIH, whatever it is, you know, initially there is no need to understand what it is, but your VB is, V in is now greater than VB but less than something. Now, since now Vin is greater than VBE, what will happen is now the BJT will turn on. As the BJT turns on, your IB is nothing but Vin minus VB by R. Okay, so I get some IB. Therefore, that will immediately give me some IC, which is beta times IB. Now, in the output loop, we know that the application of KVL will give you VCC is equal to IC into R2 or RC, whatever you use there, plus VCE. So, which means my V out, which is nothing but VCE, is nothing but VCC minus ICR2. Since IC is increasing, output will keep on decrease, which is shown here. So, up to this particular point, there was up to about roughly 0.7, up to about 0.7, it is not conducting, I get full voltage. Now, it keeps on linearly decreasing. So, this is the active mode. I have cut off here, I have active mode here. Now, the question is, which I always pose this question to students. Now, we will keep on decreasing, everybody understands. Now, my question to them would be, how low V out can become, and I get all kinds of answers. They say equation has to be valid, KVL cannot be broken, therefore, VO can take negative. Some people say no, 0, and I always take a vote in the class, okay, and that is very, very interesting. Do not ever tell the answers immediately, okay, and that makes it very interesting, and then you tell them no, V out cannot, because it is a physical device sitting there, V out can never be negative. So, this is where they must understand that all equations and equations have domains. You cannot apply an equation, say it has to be valid. But in all my 17 years of my teaching, this is a question where students fumbled, at least 50% of class fumbled. And they said, no, equation has to be correct, therefore, V out will be negative. And then you have to clarify. And this is where the biggest problem, biggest challenge is to convince them that it cannot be. And we will see how we can explain. And this being a physical device and it is a junction there, you cannot have negative voltage. And anyway, when you tell them that you are only applying a positive supply, how did you get negative? They understand, ah, okay, something is fishy here. So, since V out is VC, it cannot go below VC sat, which is the minimum voltage possible. And another very important thing we can tell them that V out cannot be negative. Anyway, two ways of explaining. One is, it is a physical device, it cannot have a negative voltage there. Second thing, you are not applying a negative voltage. How would we get negative? No oscillator, this is only DC. So, you cannot get negative. That I think they appreciate. Most of the time, most students will be won by that argument. Okay. And this automatically gives you, sets a limit for the maximum possible value of IC. So, that value of IC is nothing but VCC minus VC sat by R, okay, which means at that particular point, there is a particular value of IB, and that would give us a particular value of IC. By the way, this was the book I was mentioning about, Microelectronics Circuits by Sedra and Smith, and this has been my companion. I lost a few books also, somebody would borrow and I never get it back, and I am happy somebody at least used it. Okay. So, I have bought at least 4 such books, and the 4th one is with me. This is another very, very good book which we use here, both the books we used here. This is by Electric Engineering by L.S. Bobrow, okay, and this is also Oxford University Press and very easily available, all Indian books. And I am told, in fact, this book was recommended to us by the Oxford University Press fellow, saying that this is a book used in BITS Pilani for a long time. So, after using it, book we found it a very good book. Good thing is, this particular book has the entire syllabus of most of the courses we teach, okay, may not be in a great detail, but one book has almost all the syllabus of a. So, this is a very good book, all are cheap books, typically 300 kind of price, but this is a book I love it, okay, extremely, but I do not like that book that much as this, we talk about basic electronics. This book students would love it, because very simple explanation, at the same time very accurate explanation. Keep it side by side with Milman and Halkias, and then you will see the difference. You will never touch Milman and Halkias again, okay, once you go through it. And the coverage is very good, and somebody was mentioning about measurements. This will tell you lots of ideas about actual values, even setups and so on. Very, very good book. I very strongly recommend this book. And 5th edition, that shows its popularity, and a very, very, very good book. Yeah. Yeah. So, we talked about a maximum value of IC, which is possible in this scenario, which is directly from KVL, because mind you, I am facing very often 120 young adults, you know, looking at me, staring me, little trying to kill me, you know. So I had to convince them. So and they all happy because it's KVL. KVL is sacred, so they all agree. This is KVL. This has to be correct. So that's no problem. And then at this particular value of IC, there is a particular value of IB. So that I can directly find from IC max divided by beta as some. Let me call it IB 2. Now, since IB is equal to V in minus VB by R 1, I'll be very glad to email this to give this to anybody, everybody. Please, I think they also will be made available to you. Very happy to give. No problem. And also talk later about actual materials available, okay, for you also freely. Now, this would give you a value of V in at that particular IC value as VB plus IB 2 times R 2, which I will call as VIH. Now, up to this particular point, the graph which we saw earlier would be linear. So, what we said is, we started here at this particular point. It has reached the limit. Okay, at that point, it is till that point it is active, and that point is what I will call as VIH. So about 1.7 volts typically, which is typical of most transistors, you will get around that voltage. Now beyond this point, now we get into increasing the. I'll come to that in a minute. Now if I increase my V in beyond this, one thing is clear. What will happen to IB? Because again KVL cannot be broken. That is a very good argument, because input loop is V in is equal to IB RB plus VB, which is KVL cannot be broken. Therefore, IB will keep on increasing, but at the output side again KVL cannot be broken, and KVL says that if VC side is only 0.2, you cannot exceed, which means base current keeps on increasing, but the collector current is saturated. So the word saturation, let's say, came from here. It's saturated, but the base current keeps on increasing. There is no limit. Keep on increasing base voltage, rather V in, out the base current will keep on increasing. So the collector current is saturated. So the word saturation actually came from there. Collector current is saturated. Now, mind you, what is beta? Every input value of V in beyond that VIH, beta is changing. That's why I said careful about the word beta. Beta by definition is IC by IB. Okay. So you must distinguish between beta DC and beta, okay, which may not be very important in the first year level. Make a mistake, it's okay. But when they get into electrical engineering students, they must understand the difference. So generally the word beta DC is used to differentiate between the active region beta and the beta here. Okay. Because beta by definition is IC by IB. So always remember that. We don't have the liberty to change the definition of IB. Beta. Okay. So beta keeps on changing, rather beta is now, what is happening? Decreases. Okay. But beta DC is some value which has, I mean, which we define for the active region. So then differentiate between these two.
Sorry. In this area, they give a graph of collector base voltage versus IC, and there they have given a dotted line. Where they have segregated
the saturation
region and the
active
region. Yeah. And
in the saturation region, they have shown the collector current to be 0 to 0. I really found a difficult experiment. Yeah, I'll come to that in a minute. In fact, I don't want to discuss that in a basic electronics course at all. In fact, I seldom discuss even in analog electronics course. Now, the issue what I was talking about, I'll just come to that in a minute, because see, saturation is one, in my opinion, all this of my teaching, the most difficult thing to teach was saturation of a BJT. Op amp was very easy, digital tronic was very easy. My challenge has always been teaching what is saturation. Okay. So that is why I do not even want to get in, but we will talk about that in a minute. Okay. But let us get over this. Now, because another one issue we must make it clear, the word saturation means the current, collector current has saturated, that they can understand well. That is why the word saturation came from there, and therefore it cannot increase any further, which means in my graph, as I keep on, even if I keep on increasing my V in, my output cannot increase. Now, this property is used in a BJT inverter. In a BJT inverter, you use only these two regions. Okay. You either operate less than VB or you operate greater than VIH. Okay. This is a region very interesting. The same circuit, okay, we talk about different regions. In an amplifier, you want only this region. In a switching circuit, we avoid that region. We want only the nonlinear area. So this again, conceptually difficult for a student also. Why do you talk about sometimes active, sometimes active, sometimes cutoff, saturation? So this distinction should be brought very clearly. Linear circuits, which means amplifiers, you have to use active area. Switching circuits, you use nonlinear areas. Okay, and all of them. So this circuit has the beauty; it has all the three, and that I think clarifies a lot. Now, let coming to the issue of saturation, another big issue we have not solved. Then we come. So when we talk about features of saturation mode, we talk about IC less than beta DC times IB. Okay, and that's why the word IC gets saturated. Therefore, saturation. Now, another very important thing. This is something I want to explain. Is we wrote right in the beginning when you talk about mode of operation, the saturation both base emitter as well as base collector junctions get forward biased. Now this is again a very difficult for a student to understand, and the best way I found in explaining that is by this route. That is, we started saying that VC is sat is equal to 0.2, and simple KVL again says VCE. I do not have the transistor here, but I appreciate you can you would follow this. VCE, that means you start from this voltage between two terminals. I can get around by adding this side also. So VCE is same as VB plus VCB. That is what I have written there. Everybody understands, no problem. And therefore, VCB is nothing but VC minus VB. Okay, and VB we know is 0.7, VC side is 0.2, therefore we get VCB as minus 0.5, which means base is more positive. So this I found very easy to, both for me, first of all for me, and for others also to explain, very easy to explain. And now comes the issue. Okay, now comes, if somebody understood this step, then you will be in deep trouble. If they do not understand much, then they will stop it there. They understood well, then they will ask this question, why all of it, why, how did it jump so fast? Okay, where did it jump? In fact, this I hope you appreciate my question. See, the issue is when you talk about a transistor and analyzing a circuit, there are many jargons we use. One such jargon is VC sat is equal to 0.2. Now a friend has raised this issue. Actually, when you, how do you define reverse bias? What is your basic definition of reverse bias? Let us go back to that, then we will take up this issue. So we should accept at least that VC sat is equal to 0.2 is a jargon we use. We strictly speaking not really justified, but convenience we use. Let us use the word convenience, and that brings in lot of other problems, which actually our friend raised, that he put the exactly at the same point. Now let me get back to it. What we said is, in an active mode, the base emitter junction should be forward biased and the base collector should be reverse biased. Now what is the definition of reverse bias? How long, no, what is the extreme limit? What is the limit of, what I mean is, what should be the limiting value of VCB? Okay, VCB, till I can say that, now yes, till this point it is reverse biased. What is the limiting point? That is the main issue. No. Wait, what do you mean by forward bias? Let us take the, what do you mean by forward bias? Forward bias means like base emitter junction. Base is more positive than emitter, that is forward bias, agreed. Now if base and emitter have the same voltage, what would you call it? Will you call it forward bias or reverse bias? Okay, now let me put the question back to you again. So what is the limit? What is the limit of reverse bias, or the limit VCB? What is the limit up to which I can go and say still at this point it is reverse bias?
Anything less than 13 voltage.
Wait. Good, that is the accurate answer. Okay, but the answer I would prefer first is 0. Okay, what you said is the correct answer. Let me take up that later. Well, that brings in other problems. Okay, now see, let me take up VCB is equal to 0 as the limit. Okay, VCB equal to 0, which means VC is equal to VB, short circuit. Okay, in fact, if you want to make a diode out of a transistor, that is exactly how it is done. All ICs, diodes are made like this, okay, just by shorting the collector and the base. It is actually working as a It's a transistor. Okay, very, very important. Very important to understand that if you short a base and collector, it is still a transistor. It follows all the rules, active mode. Okay, fine. Now comes the issue our friend said. What will happen if I keep, you know, the forward bias, rather base voltage I want to increase slightly above 0, what will happen? Now, as he rightly said, as you keep increasing, you would see that as you keep increasing till it reaches around say about 0.5 volt or so, you till that point you will see no current flows. So, to be very precise, the VBC can be even up to 0.4 volt and still it will be reverse biased. If I confused you, please, I am sorry. Okay. But let me ask the point. Now, why it cannot take the same voltage as the V base emitter junction? Let me repeat the question. For base emitter junction, we say forward bias means 0.7 volt. But when you talk about base to collector junction, we are saying now do not exceed 0.4. Beyond that, you are in forward bias. Why do you say 0.4? In fact, you would see the most books. In fact, I would say Sutton Smith, that way is a very good book. You show that your V, you know, it can come down. Your base to collector voltage can be as high as 0.4 and still it will be in the active mode. Okay. 0 at 100%, no problem. But you can even be positive up to 0.4 volt. Beyond that, if you go, tuck, it goes in a saturation. Now, the important thing to remember is, mind you, these are two different junctions. That is where the device comes into picture. Okay. The base to emitter junction is what? The emitter is heavily doped, okay, whereas the collector is a very different doping. Because of this, the way they operate, okay, if you operate them as a diode, they are very different, very different. Okay, that is why we talk about different voltages here. For forward bias of the base to emitter, 0.7. For forward bias of the base to collector, we say 0.4, 0.5, toh ho gaya. Okay, that is where the distinction. But anyway, I would say because of this, there are a lot of problems. So, VC is equal to 0.2, just stick to that. Basic course, stick to VC is equal to 0.2 and say there is a gray area, I do not know what will happen. Okay, that is the best. But if you want to be very precise, you can say VBC can be as high as plus 0.4 volt and still it will be reverse bias. Okay. So, as I said, for this circuit, fortunately that did not come at all. And this is why if you actually simulate this particular circuit, what we drew over was just equations I plugged in, I plotted it, I cheated. Okay. But if you actually do a simulation of this, what do you think, how will you think the graph look like? If you do a simulation of this, tomorrow Professor Mahesh Patil will be showing SQL and all this is a very wonderful tool. Okay. Again developed here, free, you should take it with you. Okay. And it will be a wonderful tool. Okay. And if you do with any tool, what can anybody say what will be the change in the circuit in this graph? This is exactly the equation we plugged in. But actually, if you do a simulation, what will be the difference? You will see the difference will be here. Okay, here will be a very smooth variation you will find. Okay, and that is precisely because of this way we defined forward saturation is not clearly true. We can see that immediately. When you do a simulation compared with this, you will see that it goes into saturation much slower. Not as fast as we said. Okay, so that. But why do we then use this model? Why do we use this? Simplicity. Okay, always remember that our job is not to teach perfect because there is tools available. But if somebody should not use a tool without seeing this. Okay, so he understands the limitation of the analysis and understands the limitation of a simulation tool. Okay, ultimately an experiment is the right one. You will see that even after simulation, go and do an experiment, there will be a variation. Okay. But important thing is to appreciate why. Okay. And so try to cover gray areas, I would say cover slowly, don't stress too much on them, but cover it slowly. Yeah, fine. So fine, should I go over it again? But anyway, I found this extremely easy to, very liberating. Every class I can say, let me do BJT inverter again, and then the class people are happy and they understood all the time. And saturation, I could explain very well from this. And that helped, you know, the concept of what is saturation. In fact, that is the biggest mind block. What is saturation? Okay. So, current gets saturated. The collector current gets saturated, that is the word saturation. Second thing is the beta is less than beta DC, these two things, and the third thing we said is the junctions get forward bias. These three things, they understand each one term, what it means in a circuit, I think they will understand. And I mind you, even for an electrical engineering student, it is extremely important to understand what is saturation. I can tell you a complication, otherwise what will happen, when you maybe, I do not know, they have a common emitter amplifier experiment, okay. Now in a common emitter amplifier, let me put this question back to you, now tell me the answer. You take a common emitter amplifier, okay, let us say gain of 10 or 20 or something, you give an input signal, look at the output, keep in, and you say you have got a gain, everything working well, now you keep increasing the input signal, what will happen? One side saturation, one side clipping or cut off, okay, if you keep increasing it will happen. But when you look at saturation, what will happen? Just before saturation you do, something happens to the signal, if your input is sine wave, the output will be, let us say in active mode what has happened, output will be any phase difference, 180 degrees agreed. But if you see, when you increase the signal, you will see something very funny, I do not know where you have seen it, I think you should see in the lab, you will see that, when you increase the signal, you will see that the positive half, you will see not 180, 0 degrees, okay. You will have no phase shift for one half at the top peak, okay. You will see a sine wave repeating there, and the other one you will see TK. Did you follow me or shall I explain again? Okay. What I am saying is, you design a BJT common emitter amplifier, we will do that in the lab, do it, works well, gain you are measuring very well, everything is fine. Let us say input is 10 millivolt or 20 millivolt, gain of 50. You are getting 1 volt, everything is fine, very good. Now keep increasing the input, okay. As you keep increasing input, what will happen is slowly the amplitude will increase. At some point, it will get into saturation, both ends, saturation and cutoff, depending on how good or bad you designed your biasing circuit, okay. And I am assuming that it goes into saturation, not in the other one, first, okay, or whichever way, let us say equivalently it happened. If it goes into saturation, you will see that the output signal. So far it was, you had a 180 degrees phase shift, but you see that for the peak part, it is not 180, it is no phase difference, just for the peak part, that is the time it got in the saturation. Now my question is, why? Any of you seen it? No. I think I should, since I told you, I think I should rig it up and show you. This is because of saturation. What happens in saturation? This base to collector junction is forward bias. So what happens? The same signal will go through as it is, okay. See, so far your base was, collector junction was reverse biased. So the current was not getting affected by anything happened in the base. You had the all the entire thing coming into picture, okay. So you had the VCC minus ICRC coming into picture. But now once the diode gets forward biased, the signal goes straight there. If base increases, collector will also increase, voltage will increase, okay. So you will have zero phase shift for a small region, very interesting to see, again because of saturation. So saturation, I am saying, you know, is a concept which is so complex, you know, you can keep on doing it and you see things, effects happening. We should see this in the lab, I think I will rig it up, okay. So now what we will talk about is, again, as I said, I am assuming that basically that by now students have understood active mode, cutoff and saturation, you know, okay. Now they have to graduate from there, and I always found that those concepts are not clear, they are going to get stuck later. So those concepts should be made clear as much as possible, do not worry about covering syllabus, but I think we have the liberty to do that here, we may not have the liberty, but I think these things, I think they should very well, they should understand, because transistor is something which is very, very difficult to, conceptually very difficult to understand, and these questions should be answered. That is why I think an experiment is something very, 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 very important. Now the other, before we take up, in fact I like it, that is one of the reasons I like Sir Transmit very well, all his presentation, whether it is MOSFET or BJT, what he does is takes a device first, talks about the characteristics, okay, as a device, then he immediately gets into DC circuits. I like it very much, okay. I believe if somebody had taught me that way, I would have understood things better. In DC circuits, what is the advantage? you have very simple equations. Solve it, you get some number. Okay. But most books does the other way. They will talk about devices, then they straight get into application, amplifier, and you are lost. Then you talk about biasing, lost. Okay. But if you get into DC circuits, then you have a chance of trying different types of DC circuits and see some get into saturation, some get into cutoff. The issue of biasing becomes much simpler if they do the DC circuits first. Okay. Again, you can use any DC circuit, and all of us would definitely prefer at least some time using this circuit. And again, a simple circuit, but a profound circuit, so complicated. And any amount of questions I can ask from here, and I always I can find out who is a good student, a discerning student, who is a bad student, like easily, just a simple. How many times? I mean, even though it's such a simple circuit. Now, this is a circuit which we later would use for biasing, but very good circuit to teach biasing, very good circuit, and also a very good circuit to teach, for example, all the especially active mode and saturation. Very very good circuit. Okay. Now this can be simplified by using Thevenin's theorem. You can simplify the base emitter circuit into a VBB, a Thevenin voltage, and a resistance here, and we can write an equation here. So using Thevenin's theorem, we can find VBB as VCC into R2 by R1 plus R2, and I can find RB as the parallel combination of R1 and R2. That's fine. Then I can write, I can assume again, and very 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 important thing when we talk about transistor analysis, whether it's MOSFET or transistor, you always assume active. Why? In any DC circuit analysis, you will always first assume active. Why do you do that? Sorry? No, but I don't know. I don't even know whether such. See, finally, I don't know. In fact, just like we solve any simultaneous equation, what do? We use an equation, solve it, then what do we do finally? We verify. The same thing has to be done here also. But my question is, why do you assume? Why don't you first assume saturation? Let me ask the question. In this circuit, why don't you first assume it's saturated and proceed? What's the problem? Why? Very good. Because of that? No. But what is the advantage I get? What do I advantage? No. KCL cable is always valid. Linear, non-linear is secondary. KCL cable is always valid. Okay. That's not the reason. See, that's what I'm saying. As engineers, you know, I always tell students, I am happy to be an engineer. I tell them, you know, these are engineers who made fans run, you know, make cars run. Think at the same angle. Why do we do that? See, if you follow this route, you get a simple solution. That's the only reason. If I don't know the relationship with, see, one unknown, I am able to take care immediately. Just by knowing IB, I can find out all three currents, all the other two currents. What about saturation? I can't. Only one equation I can use, IE is equal to IB plus IC. That is all I can say. I do not know what is IC. So that is the reason you always take active. Okay. I mean, so that you would appreciate that only if you have a circuit in saturation, then only you will appreciate it. So that is why even for that, you start with a active. Okay. And then prove that it is not active. Therefore, it is saturated. Why not cut off? Why not cut off? What is cutoff? Cutoff means the base emitter junction, if it is forward bias, current will flow. So if it is transistor is connected correctly, which will be generally in a problem, it will be done. It cannot be in cutoff. It is either in saturation or active. Still you will take active because it gives you a very simple expression, and at least you can verify whether it is saturated or not. If it is saturated, then I know what to do next. What do I do next? No, but how do you solve? Very good, very good. See, the important thing to remember is you have many unknowns in a circuit. Strictly speaking, you have six unknowns. Which are the six unknowns? Three voltages and three currents. VB we assume, one is gone out of the window. Okay. The moment you take care of active, you take care of another two. So you see, we systematically actually we did this to make sure that you have only one unknown at a time. Okay. So that one equation I can solve. And then you say that no, it cannot be, therefore it is this. Now, so here again, that exactly the same strategy. We find the assume it to be active, Therefore, I can write this equation. I can find IB as VBB minus VB by RB plus 1 plus beta plus times RE. And from where I can find IB, then I get my IC, I can get my IE. Currents are known. Now, then I can find my VC as VCC minus ICRC, VE as IERE. VCE I can write as VC minus VE. At this point, I check whether my assumption I started was correct. If VCE is greater than VCSAT, then my assumption is correct. Okay. But if it is not, it is in saturation. Now, the moment you are in saturation, then we need to write two equations. Okay. Because now I cannot use my assumption. So, I have to write two equations, one equation for the base emitter loop, one equation for the collector emitter loop. Okay. Two equations I have, plus VCSAT I know now very well. I can write that to be 0.2 volts. And then I have to use this equation. So, I will have two unknowns, two equations, two unknowns. So, this is the third equation. So, we can write IC or IB in terms of the other one, okay, and you get two equations. But this is very, very difficult to do. Now, the next issue is this again another very, very, very important. You can have any number of problems based on this. Is basically how do you choose RC and RE? What is the role of that? Again, there is a very lots of confusion, and especially about RC. Let me ask a question. So, please listen to me carefully. I will give the circuit back to you. Now, my question is, here is the circuit. Now, let us say I found this circuit to be active, okay. And let us say now the RC is 1K. And my question is, if I change my RC from 1K, let us say to 1.5K, will IC change? Please carefully think and answer. No. Why? Yeah. So,
yeah.
See, one very, 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 very common misconception, very common, is that the collector current depends on collector resistance. No. This is a current source. Okay. In a current source, you can, this is actually a current source, rather a current sink here. But the important thing to remember is you have to assume that the RC is not too high. If it's too high, what will happen? It will go into saturation. Okay. So, in fact, that is exactly what I was trying to discuss there. The RC, let me ask another question. If you make RC equal to 0, what will happen? Will the same IC will flow? Careful. Answer, think and answer. The same circuit. If I make RC equal to 0, what will happen? Will the same IC flow or not? Good that I asked this question. Think. In fact, the biggest contribution you can do to your students is to help them to think. That is something missing today. And I always tell students the motto of IBM. Do you know what is the motto of IBM? Think. That is the motto of IBM. So, always, you know, think. What is the answer? If you make RC is equal to 0, will the same IC flow? Good. You have the guts to say that. Very good. Same current will flow. You see the problem? If you have problem, think about how much problem your students will have. Okay. So, IC does not depend on the resistance you put there. It should not be too high. The point is, it can be as low as possible, but not as high as possible. As you keep increasing RC, what will happen? VC will keep decreasing. Okay. At some point, VCE now will become VCSAT. Okay. So, the role of RC is to, the role of RC is this, that you provide an RC. Mind you, we are not talking about amplifier now. We are only talking about a DC circuit. If you keep changing RC, you must be careful that it is not too large to make VCE equal to, it goes into saturation. It should not go low. Okay. Which means you can reduce it as low as possible. Your transistor will always be inactive. But if it keeps increasing, at some stage it will go into. So, if you frame a question, you can ask a question, give a circuit active, you can say that find the maximum value of RC which will, which you can keep to be keep in active mode. Okay. Fine. So, this is something very, very important, very important, very important, and a very common misconception. Let me ask about RE. What about RE in the previous circuit? What is the role of RE? what I am asking is, if I keep increasing RE, what will happen to IE? What will happen? See, unlike IC, this is a coupled, unfortunately RE is coupled in all the equations, whereas RC was independent, okay, saw that, but RE is there in all your equations. So what will happen if you increase RE, what will happen? All currents will decrease because Ohm's law, okay. Automatically your IB will decrease, IC decrease, everything will decrease, okay. So now tell me, what is the limit on IE then? Same, you are, it is working in active region. Now what if I do something, how, what can make it go into saturation by playing with RE? If you decrease RE, what will happen? IE will increase. So at some stage with the same value of RC, what will happen? PC will come down, okay. So the role of RE, again here you talk about a minimum value below which you cannot come. Is that, see the difference between RC and RE? So the same circuit, you can have a question saying that what is the minimum value of RC in order to make sure that it stays in active mode, okay. So this is very, very important. Think about it. Just a simple calculator, a few values you can plug in and you will see. And this is extremely important from the student's point of view. If they do not understand this, biasing they will never understand, okay. The role of RC and RE must be very clearly understood, okay. And now we are not talking about amplifier at all. We are only talking about these components, how they affect biasing, how they will drive somebody saturation to cut off. Now what I want to show is, maybe at this stage, I will switch over to the other one. We will show you transistor characteristics, okay. Again, let us working there, let us hope we will work here also. Now when you talk about transistor, again the most common configuration which we use is the common emitter configuration. Now in the common emitter configuration, we talk about again being a 3 terminal device, we said you need more than one characteristic, okay. So we talk about an input characteristic and an output characteristic, okay. What is the input characteristic? You apply, you change VB and see what happens to the IB, okay. That is the input characteristic. But being a 3 terminal device, what you have to do? You have to do something at the output end. You have to keep the VC common, fixed, okay. Now if you change VC, you will get different family of curves. That is one, that is the input characteristic. Now the output characteristic is what? You have one value of IB and you keep changing VC and see what happens to IC. Yeah. So this is something where we can actually do the experiment. Yeah. Close it. Yeah, what we have here is basically, let me show you. Let me first show you what is already here, then I will go to the next, we will actually do it. What we have shown here is basically this is the input characteristic, okay. And let me just move a little bit before I actually do, let me first show you this. So what you have in x axis, you have VB and the y axis you have IB in microamps, okay. And what you have, what is done is VC is, one case is kept at 1 volt, other case it is kept at 5 volt, okay. And what do you see with, two observations, what observations can you say from here? What are the things you see from here? Input cards, if I show you this graph, I hope you can see from there. Can you see two graphs here, a white and a red one? What is the inference? Base current. Now one important thing is, this is exactly like our diode characteristic, okay. So this is exactly like a diode we are finding, that is one important thing. Second thing we are finding is, when you increase the VCE, what happens? Base current increases, okay. So this is a very important thing. Mind you, for the same value of VBE you have now, you can see this has come inside. For a smaller voltage you are having now same value of the previous value. Why is it so? Early effect, okay. This is something again basic electronics should not know about it, but later base width modulation, okay. Once you apply larger and larger VC, the base width reduces, because of which the current, which you can see that here nicely. But the important thing to remember here is this variation is very small, okay, very, very small, but it is still seen. Let me show the other one, and after doing this, we will run it again. Okay, this was just now done here, but we will do it again. Yeah, this is this particular one you see here is the output characteristics where you have VCE on the x axis and you have IC on the y axis here, and each of this family of curves is for a value of base current. Okay, and you can see a slower slope. Can you see small slope again due to early effect? Okay, because early effect will come into picture if your VCE keeps changing, the current keeps changing. That is all called base width modulation. Okay, and if you extend this curve, you are supposed to meet the x axis at some point and 100 volt typically. So, it will never meet, you are talking about 5-6 volts here. So, we will have to calculate that slope and find out what is the early voltage. Now, one important thing to notice here is, can you see this region is what? This is the active region. What about this region? Yeah, this is what he was talking about. Okay, this is a region we did not talk about. Mind you, we said saturation means VC is equal to VC sat 0.2 volts, which is not true. Okay, we are seeing that in, you can see this, if you reduce say somewhere from VC, if you reduce beyond 0.5, many things are happening. Okay, so that is why to be on the safe side we use 0.5. Okay, because if it is 0.5 of VC, I mean for example VC sat of 0.2, 0.2 will come where? 0.2 will come somewhere here. Eh? Yeah, still rough, just barely, but I am saying this is a kind of a figure we used, you know, with kind of now let us run the experiment. Yeah? Okay, let us run the experiment. It might take some time, 2 minutes, two. Eh? Yeah, what will happen is first the input characteristics will happen and then the output. So, let us do this. So, we will do this, let us hope it works again. Okay. So, yeah, what is happening in the top is the first iteration for the VC value of 1 volt and that has come here. Now, the second iteration is going on, that is for the VC value of 5 volts. Okay, it is an actual experiment. Okay. Okay, now, the other one will take some time. So, this is over, this exactly we are saying this getting the same curve as the previous one. Now, you can see here again, here is each curve will come here and that fellow will keep coming down. So, you can see here the line here, I mean basically at a particular voltage of VC you can find out what is the kind of different base currents. Now, what is something interesting here, just looking at it, what can you say about beta? What do you think? Looking at these graphs, what do you think about beta of the transistor? Now, this kind of an equipment if you buy, this is called a curve tracer. You buy an equipment from some company, will charge you at least 5-6 lakhs. Okay. This whole thing did not even cost us, maybe 30,000, 40,000 rupees. It can be even cheaper. We are trying to make it even cheaper. Okay. So, you do not need a very costly equipment to do such anything, but if you buy an equipment, it will cost you 4 or 5 lakhs. Okay. A curve tracer, very costly, but this is exactly what we are doing, curve tracer. Okay. So, you can put this in a lab, very good. Want to test a transistor, put it there, tuck, will test and tell you. In fact, you can write a little bit, tell you the beta also. But you look at the graphs, what do you think about beta? Is it, my question is, if your beta DC fixed or is it increasing or decreasing or anything? Strictly speaking, it is very difficult to say from here. Strictly speaking, beta is a function of IC also. Okay. There is a value of IC for which the beta is maximum. Okay. And generally, in a specification sheet, the transistor is designed for a particular value. Okay. Like depending on the application of the transistor, if it is a power transistor, you are talking about large values of IC. Okay. But you are talking about a, let us say a small signal amplifier used for an amplifier kind of application, you are talking about a very small value of IC. Very small means 1 milliamp. Okay. Typically, if you are talking about a low noise amplifier kind of a transistor, typically they will never talk about more than 1 milliamp. Medium like SL100, they will say talk about all characteristics, they will specify 10 milliamps. If you talk about you know kind of a power transistor, 2N3055, he will talk everything about 1 amp. IC 1 amp, he will make all specifications. Okay. The point I am trying to make is there is a value of IC for which the transistor has been designed. So, it is optimized for that value. So, when you keep changing your IC, your beta also will change. Okay. generally not drastically, but you should not neither operate at a much larger current or a much smaller current. Especially lower currents will give you what? Higher beta or lower beta? Lower collector currents will give you higher beta or lower beta? Lower beta, okay. Generally, beta is supposed to be almost kind of linear, but it is not quite. After some time, it kind of comes down, okay. So, it is good that we saw a lot of things. I have exactly 12:30. So, I think I will stop right here. I mean, very important you have an afternoon session also. But any quick questions, any questions? And I hope our time together has been meaningful, okay. Yeah, sorry.
How will I check which terminal is, if I don't know that the body is collector? So yeah, using multimeter will check. So in multimeter, like in diode portion
check.
Is there,
yeah,
if we
yeah.
turn the knob towards that portion and we check, we find that the value comes in 3-digit value comes.
Yeah.
So whichever words. Is higher, we consider that that terminal is supposed to be like for emitter and for collector. So I didn't understand how we judge this one.
Maybe you will be able to. My understanding is generally you take a normal transistor, try to measure the base emitter voltage, the diode check mode, check the base emitter voltage and the base collector voltage. You would find that generally the voltages are almost similar. But when you measure the VCE, you check, try to check there. In one direction, I mean that is how you can find out, at least in the multimeters, earlier multimeters, the analog multimeters, you would find that when you measure between collector and emitter, you would find in one direction you will find, you know, current kind of slightly higher than the other one. So that way you can uniquely say this is collector and this is emitter. But with modern instruments, maybe madam will be able to say, can you distinguish between collector and emitter given a transistor just by check device? Very difficult.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because one of the biggest problem is, as you know, in any semiconductor, the variation of parameters, in fact, this is one very important thing about a semiconductor discrete device. The variation of parameter from one sample to another sample is huge, sometimes can be as high as 100%, okay. So even if you have from a good manufacturer originally also got, you might have a lot of variation. So it is not a good idea to, so best thing is, that is why people use curve tracers. If you put a curve tracer, you can immediately see the characteristics. In my opinion, it is a good investment. Give us a project to one of a BTech project, okay. You can give it using a simple diode. You do not need anything sophisticated like this. You can make using counters and all, you can do this, okay. But it will be a good investment. Maybe a simple one graph you need, one base current, one collector current, put an insert. This is LCD displays are very easily available. You can nicely get. I would say it'd be a good investment, and your students will also feel happy, you will also feel happy, okay. And a curve tracer is the best any day, because very often what happens is you do not know whether a device is working. A simple diode test will not tell you if it is good or bad. So your simple curve tracer will tell you this is a beta. You want to know what is a beta at a value of IC, which is very important. So have a simple circuit by which you can adjust the IC, okay, and measure the IB with a multimeter or something, and it will give you a simple curve tracer. I would say give us a decent project, good project for your college, a simple diode test. Okay, some simple such things, nothing sophisticated, simple you can make, and it will be a good project for the lab. Let it be for the analog electronics lab, you know, put it there. Yeah, another important thing I want to say was, we, if you are interested, we can make, not that what we are doing is the best, but another very, very important component of teaching is good assignments, okay. So this is the assignment which we used in the last semester for transistors, a variety of problems, the most of the things I am talking about are here. If you want, we can give you a full set of assignments which we used. Okay, you are free to use it, no problem. Now, similarly for diodes also, why I am saying is problems are very important. Okay, and the problems should be chosen such that they cover a range of problems from very simple to, you know, reasonable complexity, and all those problems should be available. We can make all this available to you, no problem. Just one more thing before I close, two major web resources are available to you. Okay, one thing is NPTEL. I hope this will be made available to you. I think all these notes are available. If you just put NPTEL, if you just go to the NPTEL site, type basic electronics, huge IIT Roorkee, there is very good both web course and video course. Look at the web course. Okay, the entire syllabus is covered, and very well simple coverage is there. Okay, another one is, for example, Professor Mahesh Patil, tomorrow he will be taking lecture. His entire course and more is put on his website. Okay, tomorrow he will give. I think I should not let him. Okay, very good. I have been also using it. You are free to download. Okay, in fact, we believe in just taking it, because we have got a lot from the nation. We have to give it back to the nation. Okay, and the best way to give it back to you, because you are, you know, serving many more students than us. So please feel free to take it and use it. Okay, so there again, tomorrow he'll, if you go to his website, he'll tell you. Our E department, go to Mahesh Patil, you will get the entire thing, can download, take it, just use it. Okay, and the entire course is covered and more, lot more. And we designed it basically for the basic electronics course which we have here, first year for all students. So you feel free to use that. Thank you very much.